Thank you for joining me for another edition of the Bob Sullivan Show. Today I have on with me doing a three-way show. This is a first in probably since episode 11, but I have Justin Lovett and Jabari Davis of TheOpinionNation.com and avid Lakers fans. How are you guys doing today?
Well, I can actually, you know, I'll take the Lakers fan charge, but Justin's not quite the Lakers fan. He's probably out here in L.A., but not quite. Justin?
Are you?
Yeah. Thanks for having me on the show today.
Yeah.
Definitely not a Lakers fan over here,
Wait.
But I do respect the franchise.
Well, what team are you a fan of?
I know everybody's going to laugh, but I'm actually a Minnesota Timberwolves fan.
Oh, actually, I respect that.
Yeah, a little something different.
Well, my mother's from Minnesota, so I've always respected the franchise. Well, not respected, but I followed them. And I always
he had a fond appreciation.
Yeah, and I always appreciated what they did for Latrell Sprewell, giving him some work there towards the end of his career.
Yeah, he's gone there already, huh?
Oh, yeah.
He must be 8 million's not enough.
No, it's not enough to feed a family. I mean, it's a real bitch to pay to feed your family on that kind of money.
Absolutely.
Did you guys order the Pacquiao Bradley fight, or did you just follow it? What was your what did you guys do for that fight?
I'll start. I didn't see the fight. I was following ESPN.com, and then also obviously following Twitter to see everyone's round by round reactions.
Yeah, how about you, Jabari?
Yeah, I'll say this: I didn't order it, but I watched it. Live. I'm sure Justin saw my round by round reactions and my absolute shock and outrage at the end of the fight. Even though full disclosure, heading into the fight, I tried to convince myself that Timothy Bradley had a chance, and I even predicted the Timothy Bradley upset. But the only upset was the judges either getting it backwards or I don't know what they saw, because the fight that I saw was not a Bradley victory.
Are you guys all UFC'd up at this point? Are you still boxing fans or what? Because I've boxing, horse racing. Okay, which one of these three is going to be gone in the next 10 years? The newspaper, boxing, or horse racing, or all three?
I try to go with boxing. Then newspapers right behind it. Horse racing, I think it'll struggle, but it'll still stick around at this point. I've actually been on the MMA bandwagon over boxing for at least 2 to 3 years now. Boxing, really, they can really only give me one fight that I would want to see, and that's Mayweather Pacquiao. And they're struggling to even give me that fight. So boxing has kind of been dead to me for a while.
Yeah, okay, well, I'll be the opposition guy today, because while I completely hear where everybody's coming from, not just you, but everybody's saying this, boxing's not dead. It's not going to die. Every few years we have a moment like this, and it's disgusting. Everybody gets up their arms about it. But then you have a couple of decent fights, or maybe one big fight, and it makes a return. This is the thing. Boxing's been around forever. Anytime, I wrote a column about the disgust, that I felt from last night, titled "I Used to Love Her," how boxing continues to disappoint.
Right.
Obviously using, I'm not sure if you're big on hip hop, Bob. I'm not gonna assume that.
Whoa.
Track, by comment, "I Used to Love Her," where he's talking, where he's paralleling, where he's giving you the metaphorical, cover as hip hop. Well, that's my love affair with boxing, because I grew up on this. It's deeply ingrained within my genetic code. I grew up, the biggest Tyson fan in the world, but thankfully, I'm sorry?
No, go ahead, sorry. Keep going.
But thankfully, I have family members, plenty of boxing historians around me that, show me ropes and show me all of the all-time greats, so I didn't just grow up on Tyson. That said, of course,
the casual fans aren't going to be there. But if you're still an actual boxing fan, it's not dead, and it's not, you know, it's just moments like this where you just can't explain it, where you where you're left feeling like you have to defend it when it's really just a travesty.
Well, do you think that? Do you guys think that with the whole if they had a Klitschko versus Klitschko match, which will never happen because they won't fight each other. But if they were to fight, do you think that would be? I think that would be bigger than Pacquiao versus Mayweather, in my opinion. Do you think that would be bigger if they built up to it correctly?
Jesse, what are your thoughts?
I'm gonna say it won't be, just because I think that as popular as the Klitschko brothers are, I think. As far as the United States, we don't really resonate with them very well. I think, as an American public, we would much rather see Mayweather versus Pacquiao.
I'd like to go with you on that, Bob, but the problem is, had it happened 6-7 years ago, you know, or even 8 years ago, just coming off of Lennox Lewis, and then all of a sudden they're like, oh, who the hell are these big old... big old Russians or whatever they are, the Klitschko brothers, who are these guys? That would have been, you would have been, in fact, that may have saved the heavyweight division. But now we're too far removed. And, like Justin said, the unfortunate thing is they fight over in Europe. And, not unfortunate, but, unfortunate for, American boxing fans, there's no relation. Because there are no up-and-coming, great American heavyweights, or at least, there are no, none that are screaming out, screaming across the radar.
Right.
I gotta say, I don't think that fight would be more popular than, at this point, than Mayweather or Pacquiao. Even though Mayweather or Pacquiao is losing its steam as well.
Do you think that if boxing do they need a governing body? I mean, everybody talks about that. And, I mean, it's the same thing with college basketball. I mean, there almost needs to be a governing body in college basketball, too, so that we don't have, like, the mid-majors are getting, I'm a mid-major, I like Creighton, and my favorite team's a mid-major team. So, we constantly get screwed, like, the mid-majors are going to continue to get screwed. But, is there, like, a governing body that boxing needs, or do you think that it's a broken system. What's the fix to it?
I don't think there is a fix, I'll be honest with you. And this is coming from, a steadfast boxing fan. The problem is there's too much money involved. There's too many different hands in the pot. And the people that, it's kind of like, I'm not going to turn this into a government thing, but it's kind of like the situation with the government in the sense that the people that are in power have been in power for so long, have rigged the game to the point where they're so entrenched that I don't know that you're ever going to get like a singular governing body in boxing. And that's unfortunate.
Mm-hmm. How about you, Justin? What do you think?
I would definitely agree with Dubai on that one. Personally, I don't really see a fix in the matter. As far as the governing body goes, I just don't see it happening in boxing. Not really sure what they could do. There's one thing that I would like to see in boxing, maybe it would help change the sport a little bit, is I think that there's just too many belts. I think if they cut down some of the belts, kind of like, like how you see in like pro wrestling or something like that, where, they don't have like a million belts. So it just gives the fans something to look forward to when guys are, like, it means more if somebody has a title. It's kind of funny to see like Floyd Mayweather come out and he has to have three different people hold all the different belts that he has. Like, you don't even know what half of these belts mean or like who he beat to get them and stuff like that. So I just think it would just be better if they cut down the belts. Maybe that would help the sport a little bit.
Well, it's almost like when in the 70s and 80s when, I mean, there's all these teams in college football that are claim like 10 national titles in college football, but some of them are like the Pontiac Grand Prix national champion, and you don't know what it means. Now, at least that there's a singular national champion, and that's it. That's the only thing anybody cares about. So you can't have all these claims to national titles that don't matter. And also, in boxing, there might need to be something where you're not making the... If you win or lose, you're not making the same amount of money. There should be, like... The grand purse should be... Like, you're going to make... If you lose, you make a fourth of it. If you win, you make a three-quarters of the money. That would be that would be the only rule they should make, where you're fighting for the money.
Yeah, you know, that's an interesting idea. Actually, there have been, I can't, and of course, I'm on the spot, I can't think of the exact moments, but there have been times where I've heard of those type of deals. Like, even, for instance, the Mayweather-Pacquiao fight. Or one of the individuals involved in the melodrama most recently said, hey, why don't we do, like, you know, 40%, 40%, and then the winner gets an extra 10%.
Yeah.
You know, or something along those lines. And I got to agree. I think that would be a fantastic way to kind of, not necessarily clean it up altogether, but get closer to, seeing fair matches and fair outcomes.
How about you, Justin?
Once again, I got to say, I kind of agree with Jabari says on that one. I don't really have much else to say differently.
So speaking of things that are fixed, NBA, it's not fixed, but there is a, like, the people that don't watch the game or just started picking up on the NBA in the last couple of years, or like, oh, this isn't good reffing, this isn't good this isn't good that. Go back and watch any of the games from the 90s where the Knicks got screwed because David Stern decided to suspend the whole Knicks bench for leaving the bench area. And then, like, what's his name? Amari Stoudemire getting suspended against the Spurs. That was cheap. And, I mean, there's been a number of instances where there's, like, rules bended for the better team. People are up in arms over this. This Celtics Heat series, I didn't see much of a fix being in, or other than the first game where there was a bunch of fouls called in the Celtics Heat direction. What did you guys think? What was your take on this series officiating wise? Was it horrible? Worst you've ever seen? What was your opinion on the reffing?
I guess I'll go first. As far as the officiating for the series, I thought it was played well. The first game was definitely a little suspect with the disparity in, free throw attempts. I think LeBron had, like, more than the whole Boston team or something like that. But at the same time, as weird as that number seemed, you had to think about Boston. They're coming into game one dead tired. No one really expected them to win that game because they just came off of game 7 2 years ago. Maybe assuming they were playing in Miami. And Boston as a team, since they're older, they're kind of slow. So, you know, now Rondo, he got mad and said, you know, they need to start putting these guys on the ground and stuff like that. Or, you know, they're saying they need to foul them harder. I mean, it's just the team that they are. They don't have the main defenders to stay in front of people. So they're going to rack up a lot of fouls and stuff. That's why they're always rotating guys. And now they have guys like Steve. Well, his basically his sole purpose this whole series was to go and put hard fouls on people like LeBron and Wade. Kind of like send a message, just go out there, don't mess up, but, you know, give KG a little break here and there. Overall, I thought the officiating went well. I think after Doc Rivers made his officiating comment earlier in the series, that kind of turned things. But I'm sure Jabari would know. Phil Jackson was always really good at making little comments or games into the media, and then all of a sudden, the officiating changed. Card played by Doc Rivers there. But I thought overall, you know, it was a tight game. They played it well both ways. I mean, there's two physical teams. The Heat and LeBron and Wade, they're going to attack the basket, so they're always going to mean, you know, you're not going to rack up a bunch of fouls on LeBron because, again, like you said, he doesn't foul out. He really doesn't. You know, the fact that they got him to foul out one game, I think that said a lot. So I thought the officiating was pretty fair.
Yeah, I got to jump right in and acknowledge the same. You both made great points. Bob, you made an excellent point with during the question by, you know, when you said a lot of these guys that are complaining and all up in arms over this, you know, like obviously they've only been watching for the past, you know, past few years or maybe even the last 2 years.
Yeah.
If you go back history, not just to the '90s, you know, like, you know, even throughout the '80s, there have been questionable calls in the playoffs and questionable trends, you know, officiating trends in the playoffs. But that tends to happen. And again, if you're a long time fan of the sport, you cry about it when it hurts your team, but you get over it.
Yeah.
That you know, this series was officiated fine. Were there questionable calls? Yeah, of course they're going to be in every game. Look at the pace of the action. Look at the size of these guys. But you know, and it's not like all of these officials are the youngest individuals in the world and can, you know. And plus, again, they're just human beings trying to capture. You know, we're watching on TV and watching replay after replay after replay over it. They're trying to capture it in the moment while running themselves. So again, that's not an excuse for officials. It just simply is a way of saying it is what it is. In fact, historical reference, you know, some of the worst officiating I've ever seen. You know, I benefited from in the 2001 or 2002 Western Conference Finals, you know, with the Lakers and the Kings. Yeah. That was some of the most suspect officiating I've ever seen in my life.
Well, but at the end of the there was like, what was the foul differential in that? Like, didn't the Lakers go to the free throw line 30 times in the fourth quarter or something and get the game seven?
Something of that nature. But again, if you look at things in, you know, like under a microscope, of course you can pick out certain things. I reference that so that you could say this to bring it back to the Boston series. Game one, the reason why Boston, you know, yes, they're old. Yes, they're also a primarily a jump shooting team. For the most part, you had Paul Pierce, Ray Allen, and KG shooting from anywhere from 17 to 21 feet out or 22 feet out. You're not going to get a lot of fouls in that situation, especially if you're tired coming off of a game seven from the previous series. So, yes, Doc and them, they complained about it after the game, and maybe it balanced, you know, maybe the officials, you know, subconsciously balanced things out, you know, after the fact. But really, the reason why Boston didn't get any calls in the first, LeBron and them did get calls because the Miami Heat were rested. Which were relatively rested and were in attack mode, and Boston was, you know, was tired and shooting lazy jump or lazy and dead leg jump.
Well, I've gotten into this argument about Rondo and this Celtics team more than a handful of times. Why is this team considered so great? They've won one title in 5 years. They've gone to two championships. How is that a great run? It's not like, and they've been knocked out in the second round twice. What? And it's Boston. And of all places to be ripping on people, why is Boston accepting this? Either one of you. I mean, do you know what I mean?
I totally get what you said. I've never been as big on this Boston team as a lot of people have been, but I would say that I think they get a lot of credit because they pretty much played the underdog role since they came together. Even when there was big news when they made the deal for Ray Allen and they got KG as well, there was nothing like what we saw when the Heat came together. And it was, I mean, despite I guess their little circus they had, and you know, LeBron's famous not one, not two, blah blah blah. I mean, the Heat were expected to win.
Mm-hmm.
They were expected to win multiple championships once LeBron announced that they were coming together. Boston, it was a huge story. A lot of people thought that, you know, this team can now compete in the East. But I think at the time, I think Cleveland and Orlando were still favorites over them to win the title. And then, you know, they run off one. And then a lot of people, you know, like, okay, well, this team is legit. You know, KG, he brought the toughness to heart. Paul Pierce, he's heart and soul of the Lakers for who knows how long. You know, Ray Allen shoot outside, and you know, Rondo slowly growing, and he, you know, eventually he ends up being their best player as the other guys kind of get old. But you know, as the years go on, we keep saying we're kind of like giving them like the Spurs treatment. It's like All right, well, this will be their last year. Guys get old, and then every year they're the underdog, and they compete just as well as anybody else. So I would say I don't think the team itself can't measure them by championships or anything like that, but I think they get a lot of respect because every year we expect them to kind of fall off or whatever, and they persevere.
Yeah, I got to 100% agree with Justin. The reason is, to be honest with you, Bob, is because they won in their first year. Had they not won in their first year, the narrative on them would be somewhat different. Say they won in their third year, they'd still be given obviously all types of credit. But coming out, you get together, you win in your first year. That is pretty significant. I agree with you. Over the last 5 years, they haven't been quite to the level that maybe people have wanted to place them. But we also have to give credit where credit is due. They do come out and they scrap, and they do come out and they fight, and they and if you're going to beat them, you don't have to beat them. They're not going to give it to you. And the same can't be said for a lot of other teams.
Do you think that their game probably was, if they had come together maybe, at the age they are now, if this team was put in maybe the 90s, they would have had a better shot. Because every team is 20 times more athletic than they are now. Paul Pierce is not an athlete. He is not athletic. He is not athletically gifted whatsoever. And Ray Allen can strictly shoot. Garnett wants to be a tough guy, but I would not put him in the tough guy category. I 100% agree with Charles Oakley on that point. But with Perkins, if they had Perkins still, with that group in the 90s, they're better suited to win and give Jordan a run. Maybe get a one ring in that 90s era. Because they're a scrappy bunch, and scrappy does not work right now. It just doesn't work. And for as much as I hate to say it, it just doesn't work. And do you think that there's a... that there's gravity to that, or do you think that that's ridiculous to think?
I can see where you're coming from with that. I'll say this: they're not beating the Jordan Bulls, not in the early '90s or the late '90s. They might be able to contest with '95 and '94 and '95.
Oh yeah.
But I think the Dream gets. I don't think they have an answer for the Dream. Kendrick Perkins couldn't use that body to knock him because the Dream would just go around him. And to be honest with you, even though KG was fantastic, and I know Justin's Timberwolves heart is probably clenched up right now. I don't think the best of KG can get with the best of the Dream. I just don't.
But
it's an interesting point. So Justin, what do you think?
It's hard to place them in the 90s and wonder if they would be successful when every team would have to go through Jordan, especially if they're in the league. They wouldn't even get to sniff the finals because they wouldn't be able to go through Jordan.
Well, they wouldn't
cancel out the 90s thing. They would be competitive, but just the fact that they would have to go through Jordan, it wouldn't work. But if you want to move on to the early 2000s, mid-2000s, you're looking at Spurs going on runs, the Lakers. I think Boston will be able to, I think this team will probably be able to make it to the championship against those teams. But again, I don't see them beating the Lakers with Shaq. I don't see them beating the younger Spurs teams. I think their best shot is actually this window that they have now, or they've had over the last couple of years. And I think even this year, they would have had a great shot. But Danny Ainge, he outfunked himself when he thought he was getting over by trading an injury-prone Kendrick Perkins. He thought he was going to get a young guy in Jeff Green. And not only did that leave a huge void on their team in terms of size and just his Kendrick's presence, but they got back nothing for it because Jeff Green, he played half a season and then unfortunately he had the heart ailment this year. So they basically gave back one of the anchors to their team, someone that brought a lot of toughness and heart. And as you can see in this Oklahoma's
playoff run. He's been huge setting screens. I'm sure Rondo would love to have Dick Perk out there setting some of those screens for him. That would open up a lot of things for the team. And then also, KG has had to play somewhat out of position at center the whole playoffs. So I think that...
It's more than out of position for KG to be playing center. You're being more than kind. You're more than kind saying that KG's out of position at center, because he's length.
It helps him that the Heat didn't have Bosh, so it was basically KG out of place at center. But he had to worry about Haslam and oftentimes LeBron, who he quietly abused. He's the only player I think I've seen this season that LeBron showed he actually can guard.
Yeah, because KG's been using that length for so many years. It's like Rasheed Wallace towards the end of his career.
Yes.
It's almost like he got older and even less able. You were even less able to guard him because he had that little turnaround long arm shot that you just couldn't get to. I'm with you. KG obviously has been playing out of position. Playing out of position, but I'll be honest with you, I think it kind of benefited him. He doesn't have it. To bang with the power boards anymore, which is why if you look at his stats over the course of the second half of the season, they actually improved not necessarily exponentially, but there was a definite improvement when Doc went ahead and switched him to the center. The reality is there may be five quality centers in the league these days.
Oh,
but we know there's 15 to 20 quality power forwards.
Yeah. Well,
very true.
What? With KG and so KG, Ray Allen, I like how the Heat won this series and we're not talking about them whatsoever. But the thing is this Heat team or this Celtics team, I mean, Ray Allen's a free agent, KG's a free agent. Do you think KG has too much pride to go down the Kevin Willis route or the Eldon Campbell route of being a 11th man on the bench or something like that, where he's at the end of his rope? I mean, he has more left in his tank, but does anybody else think he has anything left in his tank? Do you think he has another, he's going to go somewhere else, stay in Boston, retire? Justin, what do you think to start?
If you asked me that question in the beginning of the year, I would have said KG is probably, this will probably be his last year in Boston. I think he'll stick around just because he thinks he can still play. Mid-season, I'd probably go with the same opinion right around the time when they were talking about, trading some of these guys away. I actually was thinking KG would be a nice player for the Lakers to pick up. Because they say, he loves it out here, he trains out here, he has a house out here. We all know he has a strong relationship with Kobe. It was well assumed that Pau Gasol was getting traded after the season. I thought KG would be a nice little fit for the Lakers team. But actually, after watching them play through the playoffs and win multiple game sevens and just, it was the perfect story for the type of team that they had, the way that they just did it out. Series after series, and ultimately losing to the Heat. I would say that KG, he'll stick around in Boston. I think he has at least two more years left in the tank. He just needs to stay healthy. He's playing good ball the whole playoffs. As far as everyone else, I think Ray Allen is gone. I think his legs were gone. They were shot the whole playoffs and the late regular season. He stays in great condition and stuff, but I think he'll continue playing in the league. He'll just be with another team. I think they'll keep Rondo, Paul Pierce, and KD and try to get some youth around them.
I gotta agree with that. At the end of the season, it was the exact same thing. I 100% thought KD was done. Unfortunately, I didn't take into account the lockout, especially in terms of the older big men, getting their bodies going and getting activated. But after watching this playoff run, KG definitely has plenty of fight left in the tank. He's no longer a starting legitimate power forward, but he's also also not at the other end of the spectrum. He's not an 11th man. He's not quite the, you know, Kevin Willis, you know, type, right. You know, type class. He's somewhere in the middle, somewhere around the 7, 8, you know, 7, 8 guy, the first big guy off your bench, a guy that if you can get in at 25 minutes of optimum KG, you know, activity, you know, he can still be very productive, whether that's, you know, whether that's remaining with Boston at a veteran's discount, or, you know, or heading over to a team like, you know, another, you know, team, you know, right around that level, like the Lakers or, you know, or any other team.
The Knicks.
I don't see him hanging him up. I'll be honest with you, I think KG got will probably play another 3 years, you know, when it's all said and done. Ray Allen, I'm 100% in agreement with that as well. I think he's done as a starter. I do not believe in him as a starter on a title contender anymore, but I absolutely believe he can be a contributor on a title contender. I hope for his sake, you know, his pride doesn't get in the way to the point where he's not willing to come off somebody's fence. Because I do think that, you know, that can extend his career. Hey, you don't forget how to shoot. You may lose your legs and not have to burst anymore, or may have, you know, slight injuries that will, as a jump shooter, as you get older, will really hinder you. You know, like in these crucial playoff moments. But you don't forget how to shoot. So somebody, you know, Ray Allen will be playing for somebody next year. Just no longer in a starting role. I don't believe.
I hate it, and I simultaneously love it. The idea that this rumor is being floated around that Ray Allen to the Knicks or Ray Allen to the Heat. No way, no way, hell does he be able to get on a flight to Miami to even work out for them without Boston making sure that plane has some engine failure so that he can't get off the runway. They'll let him go to the Knicks because they know he has no chance to win there. But with the Heat, there's no way that... I don't see the Heat thing happening. New York, I can see happening because it's close, and I think that... Well, they definitely need a three-point shooter that's not J.R. Smith, and I'd love Ray Allen to come into New York just because he can choke... Just because he knows how to choke in the playoffs.
Well, Bob, I got a question for you, if you don't mind. Sorry, Justin. Yeah, go ahead. What if it's a situation, here's a cross-reference for you. What if it's a situation like the McNabb circumstance?
Ooh.
Like when McNabb was leaving Philly, when they knew, they obviously, Andy Reid obviously knew that McNabb was done. I call him the rat, but I'm going to show him his respect, the coach in Washington. But he definitely got OVA over in that deal, as we see that Donovan wasn't. What if it's a case like that where Boston just knows Ray Allen is done and they don't mind him going to Miami because they don't see him as that much of a threat?
I wouldn't say it would be something. I would say it would be more along the lines of, oh man, that's a good question. I don't think they know he's done. I think they're not gonna sign him to prevent him from going to the Heat. I just think that he has too much dignity or class to do something like that. Am I wrong? Am I overestimating Ray Allen as a person, or do you think he even gives a crap about that?
I see Derek Fisher in an OKC jersey.
Yeah, but Derek Fisher also played for the Warriors, and he played for the Jazz, and he walked out on the Rockets. So, I mean, oh, man. And, well, that's a good question. I don't know.
I would say that Ray Allen, I don't think he'll be in the Heat jersey, but only because for the money and his what his role would be on the team. I think Ray Allen will go anywhere if it's the place that gets him the most money. Basketball player first, wants to win, obviously, but he does have a championship, and, you know, money talks. So whoever, I would say, whatever the best team is that is offering the most amount of money is where he'll ultimately end up being next year. If the Heat had the money and they could do that, I don't think he would have a problem going there. But, you know, I think he'll be able to get a better deal somewhere else. Whereas, you know, to have Wade and LeBron on the wing, so you would definitely be coming off. You have a come off the bench role. So I don't think the Heat would be a good fit. I think the Knicks are a good fit. They can use the shooting guard, but if you play out and use somebody where your game is coming off the screens and getting the ball at the right time and stuff, it'll be hard going from Rajon Rondo, who's one of the best passers in the game, somebody that he had been playing with for years, somebody that knew his game, knew how to get on the ball in the right places, to going to Jeremy Lin, Baron Davis, whoever else is playing point guard with the Knicks. It wouldn't be a good fit for Ray Allen there. He's not somebody that can create his own basket, so he has to go somewhere with a strong point guard. If New Jersey finds a way to keep Hero, however that may be, if that means getting Dwight Howard, which I don't think is likely, or maybe getting some other pieces, I think Ray Allen would actually be a good fit somewhere like New Jersey, where you have a strong point guard and maybe an up-and-coming team that is probably a playoff contender, but not a championship contender.
See, that right there is why I'm glad you got Justin on the show today, because I agree. And I also think the Clippers would be a good option for him as well.
Oh.
I know that I know people, people forget about him because they only, they've only had this 1 year in recent years. But the Clippers are still going to be around next year, and obviously with CP3, you got to look at Ray Allen as like an old receiver right now, like in football. I know that, sorry, Bob, I know I keep on going back to football and you're going to other sports, but the reality is, Justin's right. He needs a good quarterback right now, and going to the Knicks, I'm sorry, wouldn't be in his best interest. Even though the Knicks would pay him.
How dare you? How dare you rip on my New York Knicks on this show?
I'm not. I promise you. I'm only saying, if I'm a shooter that can't create his own shot, doesn't have quite the same lift, and I look at Jeremy Lin as an option, and I look at CP3 or Darren Williams, I'm probably going to go with one of them.
Unforgivable right now. I mean, you think, I 100% agree with you. Jeremy Lin, no. I would not, I mean, Jeremy Lin was lightning in a bottle. I love the guy. But why Ray Allen is toughing it out on ankle spurs in the, or bone spurs in his ankle in the conference final, basically the entire playoff run, that was what he was battling through. And Jeremy Lin was 85% when Ray Allen was maybe 22%, and we couldn't tell whether that be Boston's really good at covering up injuries or Ray Allen's just the toughest SOB in the business, which I'm not buying that either. But Jeremy Lin, this did not get enough criticism as it deserved. The guy did not play in the first round. He could have come back. Granted, he never played well against the Heat in the regular season, but damn it, Baron Davis got injured, and basically, once he got injured, that was it. And when Baron Davis is a 30-something-year-old Baron Davis who's morbidly obese and is having trouble walking as it is, blows out his knee, we needed Jeremy Lin in that situation, and he didn't come up big, and I would not give him a contract right now off of eight games of greatness. He's not going to fit in well with Melo. He's not a great distributor, and D'Antoni's not the coach anymore, so let him go. And if that means opening up cap room so that we can get Ray Allen, bring it on. I'd love to bring Ray Allen in. Where do you think he ends? I mean, if he goes to, do you think the thing with the Clippers that would scare him off is the fact that Vinny Del Negro's back?
Vinny Del Negro had his team in the second round and competing. I've been, and everybody knows me, I've been a big Later of Vinny Del Negro, but I questioned his ability, his capability to get a team over the top. I'm not questioning his X and O's. Obviously, the guy's playing the league. He knows basketball. But I've always questioned whether he was the guy that, you know, could even get you past the first round, let alone, you know, in contention.
Right.
I gotta take a step back from that now, because he did show, and that team did improve, and I know CP3 will make that, you know, make a huge difference, but you don't, you know, it's not like they were coaching themselves out there, you know?
No, not at all.
Yeah, you know, so I gotta give him a little bit of slack.
What about you, Justin? What do you think?
Yeah, I mean, you got to give Del Negro a little bit of credit. Hearing a lot of people's respect, I think this, I mean, for the whole season and definitely for their run in the playoffs. But I think you have to take into perspective how much respect people were giving him. The respect level for Del Negro was, it was kind of, you know, in the toilet. So, you know, he earned a little respect, but, you know, still don't think very highly of him, but we'll put it that way. I think Real will be a good fit on the flip, but I'm actually glad you brought that team up. I think CP3, I mean, any shooting guard would want to play with Chris Paul, and the fact that you have a Blake Griffin inside to draw double teams and stuff, it would open up Ray for the shots that he's comfortable taking, you know, the shots where he really makes his money. So, you know, if the Clippers, you know, can get the money out there, and I think they'd be a good fit for him.
Here's a question for you. What about with Neil O'Shea, Clipper GM? I know nobody in the world knows who he is other than people that are actual Clippers. Like all eight of them.
Yeah, he's,
you know, Marshall, her family.
He's now with Portland.
Neil O'Shea, you know, was a guy that was, you know, was the ex, you know, now, ex-Clippers GM has taken over the vacant spot in Portland. He was, you know, people have said that he was the architect of this team. Who, you know, and it's, it sounds crazy to say the architect of the, you know, of the Clippers,
yeah.
But... Well, any of the free agents have any questions about signing with them now? Because there are rumors that Neil O'Shea took that job specifically because he, you know, for one, didn't believe in Vinny Del Negro, and as everybody seems to have, had difficulty dealing with Donald Sterling.
Well,
I don't.
Everybody knew who Neil. Well, anybody who had half a brain or lived in L.A. knew who Neil O'Shea was, and the only reason people know who he is now is because Donald Sterling decided that he was having too much success, and he wanted to bring the Clippers back to mediocrity. So now you guys have to expect some more torn ACLs from Blake Griffin or from CP3, and you're going to have to expect some knee injuries. This is Donald Sterling's plan of being the worst owner, and then he might bring back Elgin Baylor. You never know. The Lord of No Rings, bring him back to be the GM of No Brains. I'm sorry, Jabari.
I'm sorry.
I know you're a Lakers fan. I had to say it. I'm sorry, Jabari. I know you're a Lakers fan. I had to say it, though.
No worries. I'll address that afterwards. I'm sorry, Justin.
I was just saying, I don't think that the GM position will alter anyone's opinion or view if they should go to the Clippers this offseason. I think you just have to really just think about Chris Paul. I'm pretty sure that he had a play in Del Negro's contract extension. I'm pretty sure if Chris Paul wasn't down for Del Negro, then he wouldn't be there, because ultimately the most important thing for the Clippers the next two seasons is to secure Chris Paul and Blake Griffin long term. So they need to keep both of them happy, at least until they get them to sign those papers. So Del Negro, you know, getting the extension or the short extension, I think Chris Paul had something to play in that, and free agents will ultimately look at who the players are, not the coach necessarily and the GMs. I mean, just about any player in the league wants to play with Chris Paul.
I would.
Yeah.
He could make me an all-star.
Yeah, you saw what he did with that Hornets team last year.
Oh yeah. Well, don't
carry them on his shoulder.
Well, and let me. I had this argument. I've screamed this 1,000 times at the co-host for this other show that I started about Rajon Rondo and Chris Paul. And his argument is, well, Chris Paul's only gotten teams to the second round. Rajon Rondo's won an NBA Finals. Rajon Rondo, without Sam Cassell, I don't know if that team doesn't that team wins the finals with Rajon Rondo solely as the point guard. And also, Rajon Rondo, name me one guy that he's turned into an all-star that wasn't already an all-star before he started with him. Rajon Rondo is the most nurtured superstar in NBA history, and there's no argument. I mean, I guess he'd probably be like the Scottie Pippen of superstars. Like, Scottie Pippen wouldn't have been a superstar without Jordan. Am I wrong on this?
I always talk about this with people, actually. As we get further and further into the season, you know, people always say, you know, we see big playoff moments from individual players, and we automatically start saying that they're the best at their position or whatever in the game. And for a while, we would always forget about Chris Paul because, you know, whether he was making it to the playoffs and we knew he wasn't going to really make a real run. People like Derrick Williams were still around, Rondo's and stuff. Even like a Derrick Rose, you know, we're quick to say the last guy we saw have a dominant performance, we're quick to call them the best.
Right.
And I think that's kind of unfortunate. And for Rondo, because his team, I mean, no disrespect to Rondo, he's a great player, but because his team has, you know, been sticking around and making long playoff runs the last couple of years, a lot of the times we go with what we see. So we see Rondo, you know, but playing great basketball in the playoffs, but then we forget about the other greats just because they're not playing anymore.
Yeah, I actually agree with that as well. But I'm somewhere in the middle on Rondo. You'll have people that will swear by him. You obviously, Boston fans will swear by him, and then you'll have, and not surprisingly, a Knicks fan will say that he's, you know, the most nurtured star, you know, in basketball history. Even though I would throw Andrew Bynum out there as one of those individuals, but you know, that's neither here nor there. Rondo, when he first came in, obviously was not the point guard that he is right now. If you go back and you watch, I actually agree with you, Bob. If you watch those early years, without Sam Cassell, without some of the veteran guards that they had on the team with him, they probably don't win that title. Not to mention not to forget, they also had PJ Brown and who's the guy, the lanky guy, James Posey. That was a great.
Forgot about
it. I'm sorry?
I forgot about James Posey.
Yeah, that was a great roster for that one year, and they did it. But that said, if you watch Rajon Rondo, it isn't just a matter of a couple, you know, postseason, you know, the highlights, and it isn't just, he has become a very, very good point guard at this point. Yes, he still has, the often talked about big three there, but quite frankly, he has extended KG's career. He has, his activity, his floor, the way that he controls the floor, even though he can't, he's still not a consistent shooter, Rajon Rondo, and I'll be the one guy to argue this, is a top two or top three point guard in this league.
Ooh.
I know, Bob.
Okay.
I know that hurts.
Okay. No. I will say I'm giving it to him. I'm giving it to him. Yes, he's a top three, maybe, I'd even put into the four category. But he's definitely great, but he's definitely not where he is right now without the, without the backing. Sorry, I was playing a scratch-off ticket. There was a time when, he was the biggest question mark on that team going into the big three coming together. It was the point guard. Is he really
where he is today if he doesn't get those big three? If he doesn't get those big three, is he where he is today? He has a lethal shooter, he has an athletic four, and he has Paul Pierce to bail him out of any quote-unquote clutch situation. And, I mean, no, Chris Paul didn't have that. Derrick Rose doesn't have. He has Kyle Korver and Luol Deng, but I wouldn't consider them Hall of Famers. And Deron Williams certainly has not had that kind of luxury that Rondo has. If you get CP3 or Deron Williams on that team from ever, that team wins five championships in a row. It's not even close.
No, you're right. You're absolutely right. I'm glad you didn't say Derrick Rose on that one, because Derrick Rose would not fit with those stars. But you're right. If CP3 and Deron Williams had the type of roster around them that he has, they'd be winning titles. But we shouldn't knock Rondo for his circumstance.
Yes, we should.
You know, it's like.
I'm sorry. Go ahead. I was kidding.
No, don't worry. Justin, how do you feel about this?
It's kind of piggyback off of what you both said. I think that Rondo obviously wouldn't be the player he is without the group that he's had around him. I think that more so than anything, just to be around that specific group where it's all about heart and toughness. His skills have always been there for him. I know he was just a young guy when the team first came together, but if you just go back into his basketball career, back to college, and you look at his numbers, he dominated at Kentucky. I think he actually led his team in just about every category. You go back to high school, he played at big high school, Oak Hill. Running with Josh Smith, he dominated in high school. So I think that it was going to be inevitable that he became a really good point guard. But I think the fact that he was with this group, it brought, intangible things like, you know, the heart and the toughness and stuff, the grittiness, which actually plays perfectly into his game because he's flashy, but he's not a shooter. He's really scrappy. I just think he fell into the perfect position for him. Now, I don't think that he's better than Chris Paul. I don't think he's better than Deron Williams. He is in that
top conversation. But to get like I said, it's always hard to compare these guys because a lot of the top point guards in the league they're all totally different type of players. And it's easy to go off of the last person you saw, like I said earlier. So, I mean, right now we're all really high on Rondo, as we should be. As you see, there's no reason someone Rondo's size, 6 foot, I think he's about 6 feet, should be chasing Will Chamberlain's playoff triple-doubles. And I think that over the course of the last couple of years, he has gone from that young buck, the rookie, the big question mark in the team, to actually the guy that is the best player on the team easily. He's the one that carries the team. He's the one that he's the franchise guy, but he's also the glue guy. He's the one that brings all of them together and makes everybody else good at this point.
But Bob, I also think that you're right. I think that I also think Rondo would agree with you that he's benefited from those guys as well. I think I don't think that I don't think he would disagree with that point at all.
Well. Does Rajon Rondo have a, I don't know, a thing where he's almost too stubborn, like, he caught, like, their games, like, do you think that team, like, they had no scoring down the stretch at all in that game last night, and if they have just a point guard, somebody that can make a basket, for God's sakes. They had nobody that could score, and that is, Rondo is almost too unselfish for his own good. And that is, for the team, is having problems right now with, I don't know what, I mean, they don't have a score. And Paul Pierce is over the hill, Rondo is too unselfish. If he's just a tad more selfish and wants to score like he did in game 2, does that team end up beating the Heat?
I think what you're asking is it's a little unrealistic for Rondo. That big game he had, I wouldn't be surprised if he never shot that well ever again. This is not the type of player he is. He's never been a shooter. His jumper is getting better, but I don't think he'll ever be a real shooter. And that was how a lot of those baskets he got were actually from jump shots. I mean, he's very good at getting to the rim and scoring in crafty ways, but for that game, he was just on fire. He was hitting shots that he probably doesn't make. And I think it's a little fair when you look at all the things that he brings to that team to ask him to also be a guy that can score whenever you need the basket. That's supposed to be what Paul Pierce is supposed to do. That's what Kevin Garnett is supposed to bring in the outdoor paint area. That's what Ray Allen is there for. And, I mean, I think you're right. They did need another score. But they had the scores. They had decent shots down the stretch. Just nobody was making the basket. I don't think that's fair to Rondo after everything that he brings on a night-to-night basis to also ask him to do that.
Do you think he ever scores 30 in a game again in his career?
Yeah, well, I mean, he'll score 30.
I don't even remember. What was his previous career high before that, though?
You know, I'm not certain, but I feel like I know he's had at least, you know, 29, 30 against the Lakers before, because I sat there with that same feeling of disgust, like, how the hell did this guy do this? Where did this go from? No, you know, what's interesting about that is, you know, like, I see both of your points. I like, you know, like the one-on-one guy within me would have liked to see him, you know, take more command and, you know, like, in game seven. But the reality was, just, you know, like, you know, what Justin's saying is right. Those other guys couldn't hit shots. And even though, like, you know, like, when they can't hit shots, you'd like Rondo to take over. When you got a team like, you know, like Miami that plays, you know, quiet has kept some pretty darn good, you know, swarming defense, and they can funnel you. They've got, you know, Dwayne Wade flying all over the place. They've got LeBron, you know, checking him one, you know, one-on-one in big situations. And then you end up bossing, you know, some of those other, you know, long guys. Definitely, that's a pretty formidable, you know, defense to go against, especially if you don't have a legitimate, you know, surefire jump shot to fall back on. You know, we're talking about Rajon Rondo couldn't score against him. Some of the most lethal scorers in over the last 15 years are on his team, and they couldn't get anything going, regardless of what the reason was. Paul Pierce could not get anything going. You know, we could nitpick on Boston, but rather than that, let's just give them some credit.
No.
They prevailed in the end, and, you know, they earned it. They took that
theory. Okay. Both of you on this one. If the Heat win the NBA Finals this year, is Eric Spoelstra the worst coach of all time to win an NBA title?
Wow.
You know,
you go first. Let me think about this. I'm trying to think back, and
because Rick Carlisle's the worst right now, and I'd take Rick Carlisle over Eric Spoelstra in a heartbeat.
Oh, Rick Carlisle's a good coach.
I know.
Worst is an interesting term to use with, you know, with that, because Rick Carlisle, in my opinion, is underrated. I would take him 10 times, you know, 10 times a week and 13 times on Sunday over Eric Spoelstra. Darn. Tentatively, yes. Here's a more clear answer. Rick, if they were to win, Spoelstra would be the coach with the least amount on his resume.
Oh yeah, and
for sure, for certainly.
Oh, and definitely the least like he's the, as Stephen A. Smith says, he's the first non-leader of men to win an NBA title.
Yeah,
I mean look, the guy, we'll give him credit that first year that he had with. That year he got the Heat to 50 wins with that god-awful squad. I'll give him credit on that. I'll say he did a hell of a job with Beasley being his second-best player when Beasley was high 35% of those games. And then to add to the point, it seems like a situation where Spoelstra, I don't know if he's looking over his shoulder too much at Riley, but I don't think he's half the coach. If Riley's going to keep him there, what's his name? Spoelstra is not half. If they lose, Spoelstra is not half the coach that Stan Van Gundy is. And if Stan Van Gundy's getting fired after one conference finals appearance and has lesser talent, way lesser talent than this team has, Spoelstra's got to be gone after this year if they can't win it. Won't, because
the Thunder are just too good. Do you see any way he comes back if they don't win?
Watching the playoffs, and it's hard because he was going against Doc Rivers, who I think is probably the top 2-3 coach in the league right now. And Doc Rivers was clearly out-coaching Spo. Specifically in crunch time and inbound play moments. I think if the Celtics, every play that they ran could have been an inbound play, I think they probably would have beat me. But it seems like after every timeout or something, you run an inbounds play, it was always layup or lob to Garnett, and the Heat never seemed to adjust. And also in the crunch time moments, more so when Miami needed a basket, because it seemed like every game came down to whether they were going to hit the shot and win it or not. It wasn't just that they were getting bad shots off, but just as a viewer, it was hard to figure out what they were even trying to do. Like, I know a lot of times plays break down, but usually you can be like, play broke down, but they were trying to do this. But you watch a lot of their plays and you're just wondering, what do they even draw up? Like, what happened there? And it's weird that you have players like LeBron and Wade, superstars that you really shouldn't have to do too much coaching if you have those two players and then you get Bosh back. I mean, there shouldn't be a whole lot of coaching involved to get execution on the floor. But like in the crunch time moments, Spoelstra's coaching was really questionable. I think if they ultimately end up losing to the Thunder, I think he'll be back, mainly because he's Pat Riley's guy. But also, and this goes for the Heat in general, I think that this whole thing was a 3-year experiment. A lot of people were talking about when they lost to Boston in Game 5, all the trade rumors came up and said, who are they getting rid of? People don't realize or remember that just about the whole team had a 3-year opt-out in their contract. So I think this was a 3-year experiment just in case it didn't work. Everybody, Wade, Bosh, LeBron, McCaslam, and even Mike Miller, they all have the 3-year opt-out. So I think regardless of what happens in this series, they'll all give it one more shot, including bringing back Spo. And if it doesn't work again, then they'll really look toward breaking this thing up.
Yeah, I got to agree. You know, what's interesting about this is I'm the type of person where I'm pretty locked in terms of my opinions on things. And I don't know if either of you guys heard, but last Friday we did a I was on with a shout out to Ernest Christian and the Ernest Christian podcast and some of the other NBA Nation guys. And we were talking about, I was sitting there listening to Ernest there as well as his cousin Errol, shout out to cousin Errol, discussed Eric Spoelstra, and it hit me right then that, here's the thing. Guys like Mike Brady, because it rang so true. Guys like Mike Brown and Eric Spoelstra are perfect for those, you mentioned it, Bob. You did a great job getting that junkie team to a 50-win season.
Yeah.
Because when you're from a video coordinator type position, maybe you played a little bit of college ball or whatever, you've got that fighting, you've got that grit in you. You're gonna be in the office, 10 hours a day, 15 hours a day, studying tape. You're gonna have the X's and O's, stuff down. But the big difference for me between guys like Rivers and guys like Mike Brown and say Eric Spoelstra is superstars, not so scrappy gutty teams, but superstars respected if you've been there.
Right.
And whether that's fair or not, that's the reality. So that wild mentality will work on a young scrappy guy, on a young scrappy team. When you've got an established team of veterans, an established team of, you know, like guys, right in their prime, ready to make a run, the rah-rah coach doesn't tend to work. It really looks as though it becomes white noise. You hear that term going out a lot. It truly does. And in case in point, you have in instances like you had between Dwayne Wade and Eric Spoelstra on the bench, that they had, about a week and a half ago.
Yeah.
It's a matter of they like him, but I don't feel that they ultimately respect him as a leader and as, as the guy that's going to, take them to the promised land.
Do you think him and Pat Riley share hair gel?
maybe they got dual mirrors in the bathroom next to each other.
Yeah, I mean,
and they just gotta pass them off.
It's like Spoelstra's trying to figure out. He doesn't know how to. He doesn't know how to do the slick back because his hair's not long enough. But he doesn't want to look like he does. He's still a Kardashian offspring. But he doesn't want to have the slick back because then he'll look like Rob Kardashian and they'll be twins. But with the spiked hair, he kind of reinvents the way to comb your hair. And you got to respect that about the man, too. Please join us for part two of this very long NBA Finals preview that we did with Jabari and Justin. Check out part two on YouTube.